Thank you, Simon. Welcome, everybody. It's great pleasure for me to be hosting this or leading this discussion with Herbert and Carol. I ought to give you a bit of background information that as the editor of the series, the Cambridge Handbook series, I had the pleasure of editing Carol's book, 101 Tips for Teaching Primary Children, and Herbert's book, 101 Tips for Teaching Teenagers. And I have to say, for somebody who's myself, my experience doesn't really cover those areas. It was a wonderful experience because I learned an enormous amount, and I'd like to share that with you today. So I'm going to ask Carol and Herbert in turn if they could just address what do they each think is the major challenge facing their age group that they have been writing about, and then some possible solutions. So Carol, over to you. What's the major challenge for teaching that age group, primary?
Well, there's obviously a lot of overlap between different areas, but I would say without any doubt at all that the backbone of primary teaching is to do with classroom management. Because if you're not able to manage your class, nothing seems to go right. And if your classroom management is effective, everything else seems to fall into place. Now, of course, there are two crucial basic things that underpin that. The first one is to do with establishing positive relationships, both with you and between the pupils, you know, that kind of Earl Stevick quotation that I'm sure we're all so familiar with, that success depends on what goes on inside and between people in the classroom. And the other thing is providing engaging, challenging, and purposeful lessons. But having said that, we also need an armory of strategies and techniques to help us. And I think one of the main principles is that we want to establish a model of influence rather than a model of control. Of course, you as the teacher can control the children in the sense that you can impose external constraints. You are the authority. But that is likely to lead to resentment, to a feeling of victimization, to barriers to learning going up. And actually, we have to realize as teachers that there's only one person whose behavior you can control in the classroom, and that is you. And so it's really important, rather than, you know, blaming the pupils, blaming your materials, blaming the class side, blaming the institution, to actually look at yourself and your own behavior, your voice, your body language in everything that you do. Because what you will find is that they find reflection in the children's behavior. So if you shout and get angry and you use agitated body language, you don't have to be surprised that you will up the level of disruption in the class. So that's a very important thing. Another crucial thing is to actually explicitly convey what you value. Apparently, it's very typical, and I think we know this, but there's been research that's been done on it, that teachers typically praise children and give positive feedback for effort and achievement, and negative feedback for behaviour. And so if you want the children to know what you value in their classroom behaviour, you need to make that explicit. And one of the key strategies that I learned years ago when I was a young teacher just starting out, and that is CBG. And that stands for catch them being good. Because so often what happens, you take a typical example, child come into class, constantly forgets their book. The teacher is on and on at them, telling them off, you haven't remembered your book, so and so. Typically what happens is the day that that child remembers their book, the teacher says nothing. So we need to actually value appropriate behaviour positively. Another thing, and I think this is really crucial, is that when you're starting out as a teacher, you have a lesson plan. You've probably been taught and schooled in how to do your lesson plan. But very often, teachers don't have a behaviour plan. And we need, as teachers, to think through not just the lessons, but possible behaviour scenarios. This may be to do with classroom rules that you may negotiate with the children, depending on how old they are, with routines and expected patterns of behaviour, and with strategies for responding to behaviour, and the kind of consequences for inappropriate behaviour that you've thought through logically beforehand, thinking of the kind of classroom you want to establish. And one of the strategies that helps me, it still helps me, and it's something that I worked out years ago, and I call it my ABCD strategy. And this is to help you put into practice the principle that as far as possible, you never want to stop teaching and stop children from learning. So in this strategy, A stands for all on task, angelic. The children are perfect. That's your ideal. Of course, it never happens, and certainly never for, you know, 40 minutes or 60 minutes throughout a whole lesson. B is for boring but bearable behaviour. C is for caution, handle with care. And D is for disruptive or dangerous. So very often what happens, and I've seen this in classes because I've observed many, many classes, that children are doing something that is boring but bearable. Maybe they're kicking their legs annoyingly under the desk, but it's not something that actually needs to interrupt what you're doing and your teaching and the other children's learning. And actually, if you confront a child about that behaviour, you're likely to escalate into a kind of C level of behaviour. And now, obviously, of course, there are moments when there is dangerous and disruptive behaviour, and that needs to be tackled immediately and in no uncertain terms and in a voice that expects kind of immediate compliance. And actually related to that strategy is the idea of minimum intervention whenever possible. So that you want to start with low-key intervention. It may be a kind of behaviour that actually you decide tactically it's just better to ignore it. You may give a non-verbal signal. Eye contact is very powerful. I love it. Sue Cowley, in her book, sort of popular book, it's called Getting the Buggers to Behave, and she talks about the art of the deadly stare. Well, the art of the deadly stare is very, very powerful. I won't do it to you now because you might turn the Zoom off and go away. But it is very, very powerful. And what it says is not, I don't like you, never that, but I don't like your behaviour. So it might be a nonverbal, it might be a verbal signal. Okay, we're going to get our books out now. Everybody ready? Ricardo, you're ready too. You know, it might be kind of nominating the child just to make them know that you're aware what's happened. And then if we up the level, possibly it's a directed choice. You know, what would you like to do with your mobile phone? Would you like to give it to me to look after for the rest of the lesson? Or would you like to put it in your bag? So a directed choice which allows the child to take the responsibility of their decision and not to lose face. Because ultimately, in this kind of model of influence, what you're looking to do is not for you to control the children, but for them to develop self-control and a sense of responsibility and behave in appropriate ways. And just one last thing I'll add to that, and that is, because it's just so important, is the use of praise. And praise is obviously so important in kind of making children feel good and motivating them, but it's, and it should always be sincere. But you can also use praise in a tactical way to help the management of your classroom. And obviously you want to use descriptive, constructive praise, so you actually give children, you know, information about what they're doing well, not just, you know, that's a great story, but that's a great story. I like the way you thought about the beginning, middle, end, whatever it is off the top of my head. But other things you can do, for example, praise early on in a lesson, never insincere, not that, but praise early on. For example, by referring back to the last lesson and how well the children did the role play together, remind them of that, a feel-good factor from the very start. Or use what's sometimes called peripheral and sometimes called proximity praise, which is when, you know, if a child is not doing what they should be doing, not getting down to things, that you actually go to a child nearby who is displaying the appropriate behaviour and acknowledge that. And then with eye contact, the child knows that you're aware of them. And that can work very powerfully as well. And of course, we have to think, you know, with lower primary children, it's all very well to praise in front of the teacher, in front of the class, but with upper primary, whoa, maybe not, because they already are looking to their peers rather than the teacher, and it may be very uncool to get praise from them. Or you can just slip it in. By the way, it's a nice technique. By the way, well done for waiting your turn, for example. So I'm sure there are lots of other things, and I'm sure Herbert's got loads of things to add from the teenage class point of view. But yeah, one of the books that I remember reading ages ago, you probably have read it as well, is Frank McCourt's Teacher Man. And it's an autobiography about his days as a teacher. And he tells this wonderful anecdote when he's starting off teaching. And a child, I think it's lower secondary, throws a sandwich across the room. And he says, Frank McCourt says, stop throwing sandwiches. And one child says, well, it's a bit late, sir, because he's already thrown it. And Frank McCourt just ambles across the classroom and picks up the sandwich and eats it. And whatever you might think of the hygiene of that moment or whatever, he said that from then on, he had the respect of the class. But what he said, which has always stuck with me, that on teacher education courses, nobody ever teaches you how to deal with flying sandwiches.
Something that we don't have to put up with on Zoom, I guess. We should be thankful for that. Thank you, Carol. Fabulous. And Herbert, I'll invite you to, if you've got any other comments that on the subject of classroom management you might want to add that's relevant to the teens population.
Sure. Well, first of all, it's great to be with you guys. I agree 100% with the points that Carol made, sorry. It's of course, when it comes to the teaching of teenagers, some of the issues are very similar, and of course then there are other challenges too. But I agree with one point in particular that Carol made, that what we should actually aim at is influence them positively and influence them respectfully rather than trying to control them. Trying to control a group of teenagers, especially young teenagers, so when they are in their adolescent phase, can be extremely difficult. And I'd like to just focus on one example here. All the colleagues watching this who are teachers of teenagers have probably been in a situation where they enter the classroom and they notice that the students are not ready yet, okay? So maybe some may not have taken their books out and others may not have taken their coats off or what have you. And what often happens is that teachers react by saying things like, well, I'm not going to start before you're not taking your coat off. Mm-hmm. That can be a huge problem that might actually lead to a Wild West kind of showdown, because teens want to be in control. And not being in control, because the teacher actually shows them that they are the ones who control them, that might actually lead to a feeling of losing face in front of their classmates, and nothing can be actually more difficult to live with than losing face in front of their peer group for teenagers. So my advice would be, and I think this goes very well with what Carol said about teaching young learners also, if at all possible, ignore the lack of readiness. Even if one or two still have their coats on, it doesn't matter so much, maybe. And instead, engage your learners in an activity straight away. So, for example, tell them to work with a partner and write down 10 words they learned in the last lesson. Or think of a text they read or listened to in the previous lesson. Write down 3 sentences stating what they learned from the text, or 3 questions they have about the content of that text. That gets them going immediately. Make sure you have a spare a pen and a few pieces of paper ready, because they might not have that ready either. Give it to those kids who don't have that ready yet. And while they're actually working, walk around, and then when you stand next to them, go down on their face level and say, oh, by the way, could you take your coat off, if that really is something you find difficult to stare. That's to tolerate. Mm-hmm. That's very, very different from this kind of possible standoff. So influence them positively rather than controlling them. And the second point I'd like to stress, I think it's also a point that Carol made, it's about the atmosphere. It's about the kind of warm atmosphere we need in the classroom. It's about learners feeling accepted. And part of the classroom, of course, is the walls of the classroom. So I think managing the class is not only about managing the occupants of the class, but it's also about managing the room itself. So classrooms are sometimes maybe tidy but sterile. And sometimes, especially when it comes to teenage classrooms, I've noticed that the classroom walls are overloaded with pictures of celebrities from the glitz and glamour of the pop and film world, maybe because colleagues sometimes think they want to put things on the classroom walls that teachers sort of like. The problem with that is sterile is not good, because it doesn't give this kind of warm welcome atmosphere. Overloading walls with what we believe teenagers might like distracts them quite frequently, while getting them to pay attention to visuals that make them curious or make them feel at home or welcome, that would be a better strategy. I mean, for example, having photos of yourself, a few photos of yourself on the classroom wall, maybe in situations that make students curious and make them ask questions, maybe even photos of you when you were their age, for example, photos of that you have taken of your learners, maybe. At school events, print them out. That tells your learners that you have an interest in them. And then maybe newspaper clippings, inspiring quotations, posters reflecting some positive values. Things like that, I believe, can contribute to what I call a positive psychogeography of the classroom. In other words, things in that classroom that have a positive or big impact on the quality of the learning that takes place within them. So that's just two ideas.
I like the fact, actually, I picked up on this, that both of you referred or made a point of saying, referencing previous lessons. And that's something that, again, applies equally to teaching of adults, to perhaps we don't do enough, is kind of linking lessons and keeping that continuity going. Herbert, while you're in full flow, would you like to address what you think is the biggest challenge for teens in your experience?
Okay. There are probably several, but one huge challenge, also according to many colleagues I've spoken to over the years, is motivating teenagers, especially, as I mentioned previously, young teens or adolescents. Students' level of motivation often depends on whether they have a clear answer to the question why they should be learning what they're supposed to be learning, okay? So that shouldn't actually be a huge problem, considering the key role that English plays in things like popular culture and on the web in particular. So we know that teens and young teens love listening to music. A lot of it is in English. They love watching video clips on things like YouTube. Many of those are in English. So all that should actually work for us and support us in our attempt to motivate them. So this is not a huge problem, I think. And the question is, why can it still be so difficult to motivate teenagers? Well, in order to find answers to that, I think we need to have a look at the specific situation that young learners and young teens, are in, and especially into what goes on in their emotional and cognitive development. It's about specific challenges presented by the fact that they're going through a phase in their lives which is characterized by not just a desire to be different from their parents and from their teacher, which of course can be a challenge, but also by the fact that they have to find out, they're faced with the challenge of finding out who they are, or who they're going to be, so their sense of self, their identity, and that their worries, their fears and their insecurities are actually so strong. They're overwhelmed with emotions very often. And we also know they can be so cool, or at least appear to be so cool, especially when they are with their peer group. But underneath that coolness, underneath the surface coolness, there are often lots of insecurities. And that can make them moody, tired, depressed sometimes, provocative. In other words, not always easy to deal with. But I don't want to wallow in gloom and doom, because I truly believe that teenage years can offer great opportunities. Opportunities to influence them positively and guide them respectfully towards becoming mature and responsible adults. So let me give a few examples of the factors that could be crucial to success. I'll mention three here. Firstly, I think it's about, and I've partly mentioned this already, but it's about creating a classroom culture that they want to belong to. They need to feel that we take them seriously, not just as learners of a language, but as human beings. Secondly, I believe we need content that makes it possible for them to connect with important human qualities, because that's what they are actually looking for, among other things. And thirdly, we need to balance serious interaction with elements of surprise and fun. So what would that mean concretely? A few tips here. First of all, when it comes to, as I said, taking them seriously, I think asking them about and talking to them about real world issues and what they would do to solve real world problems, that is, I think, something that is important for teens. As long as the teacher listens carefully to what they have to say and asks good questions, shows a serious interest. So, for example, asking open rather than closed questions would be a key point here. I said the second point would be the right content. A few examples. Teenagers admire successful people because they believe that the people, the sports stars and the people from the world of pop culture and the film industry, et cetera, they have been successful in life. So they must have qualities that one needs in order to be successful. So what they do is they use those stars as projection screens, and they project onto them big human qualities, love, creativity, tolerance, courage, what have you. Which actually means that quite a lot of course book writers put into their course books, I think, texts about those stars, and then are often surprised that kids are not really interested. Partly, I think, because, you know, once these texts get published, they're so dated already. So what I would suggest is content that actually is about everyday people who are in situations that where they show those human qualities, courage or love or creativity, etc., etc. That's one thing. The other thing would be anything that is far away from kids' own reality. Okay, texts about foreign countries and foreign cultures, about things that are absurd and ridiculous and gross and strange, and what have you. Because the further away from their own identity, the better, because they feel insecure about their identity. And then the third point may be, you know, balance serious interaction with fun and elements of surprise. Use I don't know, play paper, scissors and stone with them occasionally, or use elements of gamification in your lessons. Those would just be a few examples.
No, that's wonderful. Makes me want to teach teenagers. We don't have a lot of time before I want to hand over to the question and answer section of the session. But if you had to choose, each of you, from your get it around the right way, your books, is there an activity or a tip that you would give somebody coming to this new, let's say, who's teaching at primary level for the first time, or teaching, in your case, teens at the first time, Herbert, from your book, a tip that you think which would really stand them in good stead? Carol, anything that comes to mind?
There are so many. This is a very hard question, because I'd like to tell you at least 10. But I think if you're really a new teacher and you're starting out for the first time, a tip that is really helpful is the as-if technique. And the as-if technique is basically fake it till you make it, and to kind of consciously stage act as if you are the most confident teacher in the world. Use a calm voice, use open body language, and actually, even though you are trembling inside and you know you're stage acting, children will actually respond to your confidence, and this will help you become the teacher you want to be. And, you know, in many other fields, that kind of technique is proven to work. And I'm sure we've all used it ourselves at some times in our life. I think I remember the first time I did a, you know, train the trainer course, and I thought, oh my God, how can I be training trainers? You know, just go for it, you know, do it. So I think that's one. And if I'm allowed to just very quickly add another one, because I think this is just so important and it's very, very simple, but keep your expectations high. We haven't had a chance to talk about learning differences and all that, so I don't mean artificially high for children who can't respond to them. But actually, the temptation with children is always to think that they're not capable of very much. You know, to actually, we unfortunately, you know, even without realizing it, we have, you know, unconscious bias and we attach labels to children. But actually, when you keep your expectations high, I mean, I find that if you teach six-year-olds as if they're about to go to university, they will actually respond to that. It's kind of extraordinary. And it reminds me of that, you know, you probably saw it on social media somewhere. There's this kind of viral meme that says, "My teacher thought I was smart, and so I was." And actually, I think, you know, it is this kind of self-fulfilling prophecy, and rather kind of dumbing down your expectations, keep them high. And that also relates to what, you know, John Hattie and his visible teaching, mm-hmm. and showing and sharing your passion, because it is catching. So those would be my tips.
Brilliant. You're sharing your passion, Carol. It's coming right through, loud and clear.
even through Zoom.
Yes. Herbert, in 101 wonderful tips for teaching teenagers, can you single out one, or maybe I'll allow you two, because Carol
thank
had
you.
Two.
Carol's still three.
Okay, well, very, very briefly, the other huge challenge that I can't really talk about is getting them to talk. That seems a huge challenge. Many teachers say that it's very difficult to engage students in extended talk. So two things there very quickly. The first one is use small talk a lot, but don't stand in front of the class when you do small talk with them. Try to be among them, sit with them and chat. I think this is not time wasted, but time well invested. And the second one is use anecdotes. Teenagers are usually very, very interested in who you are as a person. And I think we have a wonderful opportunity to kind of like tell anecdotes about the time when we were their age, about the friends we had and the friendships and what was difficult for us and the kind of life lessons we learned and what have you. And if we can create this relaxed atmosphere where they listen to you and your anecdotes and maybe sometimes laugh about what you tell them, and you join in with that and manage to laugh about yourself also, I think that is extremely important because it loosens the atmosphere, loosens up the atmosphere, loosens up tension, really. And one of the reasons why students sometimes refuse to talk is because they are a little bit scared of being ridiculed by others sometimes, scared of making mistakes also. And when we create this relaxed atmosphere, then this can be of huge support to them, I believe.
Brilliant. Thank you. Well, I'm encouraged by that, Herbert, because one of the things I guess I would be nervous about is applying a principle that I apply when I teach adults, which is that, you know, you share and they will share back. But I've always worried, perhaps with lower age groups, that they're not that interested in you as a person, but I'm encouraged you're suggesting that they might be. I know that I was interested in my teachers, obsessed by them when I was at school. So, you know, Simon has been, or is it Simon or Matt, has been collecting questions from the chat. So I'm going to hand over and relay those questions back to Carol and Herbert. If there were any. If not, we have a number of other topics we can still address.
Are we back? I took over. It was so good, Scott, that I took over from Matt. Thank you so much for your brilliant thoughts and idea. What an amazing panel you guys were. Herbert, it's great to see you again.
Good to see you again, Veronica, right?
Rebecca. I don't know why you keep calling me Veronica. In Brazil, he called me Veronica.
It is a bit difficult when you have a name Simon there underneath your picture. Apologies.
Does it say Simon? Oh my. Okay.
Yes, it does.
So we have a couple of questions, and then you guys can choose if you both want to answer or just one of you. This is a good question. How to control and facilitate the slow learners or struggling students? How to ensure quality feedback in the classroom?
Shall I just say something?
Yes, go for it.
I mean, I think in terms of, well, all learners are different and unique, and some may be slow and some may be fast. And I think actually this is one of the key areas that is covered when we talk about inclusion and diversity in our classes. And we do need to have a range of strategies and techniques in order to, I was going to say cater for those students, but cater is perhaps not the right, but to respond to their learning needs in a way that is appropriate. So that might be a very simple example, might be, you know, if children or students are to produce a text, that could range from having word cards or sentence cards that they actually order and stick on a sheet, to possibly doing a gap fill, to actually creating the text themselves, thinking that, you know, you've had the sufficient kind of scaffolding and preparation before that. And I think also their, you know, scaffolding is unfortunately something we've not had time to go into in detail, but it is hugely important and relevant both in, you know, what Herbert was just talking about, extended speaking with teenagers, the kind of scaffolding that enables children to have that confidence to throw themselves in to trying to say what they want to say. And that scaffolding, there are many, many techniques, of course, and it goes right from, you know, in the early stages, it may be to do with the opportunities to repeat things, to rehearse things, you know, kind of think, pair, share, that kind of stuff in pairs, to actually the questioning techniques that you use in order to probe children's thinking and at the same time provide them with language support. So it's hard to elaborate in full detail because that is a really big question, but I think my point is that it's one we have to address whatever class we have, because all classes have that kind of diversity.
So true. So true. Can I just add to this that I think it has a lot to do also with how we react to 40 language. Mm-hmm. So when students say something and they try to say something and they struggle, and obviously they make mistakes. Do we see mistakes as a sign of learning, or do we react to mistakes in a way that gives them the feeling, and often that happens non-verbally, that gives them the feeling that how they are saying things is actually awful, and that sends a huge meta message as to who they are and who we think they are as people.
Yeah, I mean, that seems to be so. I mean, this applies to adults as well, but I mean, imagine it applies to the power of a thousand to younger learners, that you value the content of what they say before you start, you know, dealing with the form. So if you, you know, however garbled it is, I think, you know, you try to catch the meaning of whatever it is and then value that, say, great, okay, but this is how you might say it better in English. Mm-hmm. But it's that validating the content would seem to be very important.
Yes.
Okay, think of that point. And I think one of the other things is to think about the way that you frame tasks and what you ask children to do in the mm-hmm. classroom. So that if you kind of have a more broad-based approach, you know, project-based learning or inquiry-based learning, where you might start with a question that might be, how are animals different, for example, but that actually can be motivating to different children and answered. They have choice in the way that they answer, and you might actually accompany that by having a graphic, you know, a choice board. So they might be able to, you know, make a video, make a podcast, write a fact file, do this, that, or the other. And those can also be differentiated in terms of challenge. And some children probably want directed choice to help them choose what to do, and others don't. And that's another way of catering for those differences.
Fantastic. Brilliant. Well, we have time for one more question. How do we define influence and control?
How do we define it?
Yeah. How do you define influence and control?
Okay. Well, thanks, Rebecca. I'll start with influence. What I understand by it is that we help them, and this is very much in line with what Carol has just said about scaffolding, that we help them to achieve goals by respectfully and positively leading them to achieving goals and or change their behavior, adopt new or more efficient strategies, develop their skills, learn techniques, etc., etc., etc. And Carol, do you want to say something about control?
Yes,
had this stare that you...
I was thinking, what a very good question that is. And although I talk about influence and control, I haven't actually thought about how I would actually define it. And I think influence is to do with creating the conditions that children or learners discover for themselves the value and benefits and of learning and take on that responsibility. So that is a kind of internal process, whereas control, in the way I was using it earlier on in this session, is to do with those kind of external constraints that you can impose.
Great, fantastic. Lovely. Great question. And I think we're probably out of time. Just leaves me to wrap up and thank you, Carol and Herbert, as ever. There's never enough time to talk about these hugely important issues without wishing to oversell the books. But I mean, you've had one or two tips. There are another 100 in each of these books. And as I said before, it was a great pleasure editing them and working with Carol and Herbert, respectively. So thank you all for attending this session, and I'll hand back to Rebecca, I think, to close it officially.
Thank you, Scott. Thank you, Carol. Thank you, Herbert.